Good morning. I'm Mike Freeman, Hennepin County Attorney. I'm very pleased to be here to announce charges in a labor trafficking case. You'll be hearing along the way from Commerce Commissioner Jessica Looman, Robin Phillips, Executive Director of the Advocates for Human Rights, and Ruth Schultz will be translating for Luis Nuez. I want to thank everyone before I go further for their fine work in bringing this very difficult case forward so we could charge it. Specifically, the folks from the Center for Workers United in Struggle, the Advocates for Human Rights, and the Commerce Department's excellent investigators. We're here today to announce that the Hennepin County Attorney's Office has today charged Ernesto Batres with three counts: labor trafficking, theft by swindle, and insurance fraud. In essence, he's the mastermind behind a labor trafficking case that exploited workers by not paying them adequately, not providing housing as they said they would, not providing workers' compensation, not allowing workers to have health coverage when they were injured, falsifying documents so that the health care coverage that he should have paid for out of what he was charging the company came out of the public coffers, to wit, out of all of our paychecks. He ironically had named his company American Contractors and Associates. He promised everyone good wages and health care and sometimes housing. Well, that's not what happened. The men worked long hours but did not receive time and a half for overtime. He did not take taxes from their paychecks and did not pay taxes for them. He did not provide them with adequate safety equipment, even though they worked often dozens of feet off the ground. He made false statements on his application for workers' compensation and for the audits with his own insurance company. But probably most heinous was the fact when a worker was severely injured, he did not want the worker to receive medical care but to go to some fake health person, although the other workers knew the man was seriously injured. They took him to Hennepin County Medical Center, and he insisted on telling the hospital staff that he'd been injured at his house and not working on a job. That allowed the man to receive emergency medical assistance from the county and from charity organizations that should have come from insurance. When some of the workers got fed up with poor pay, long hours, lack of medical insurance, and overcrowded housing in a Bloomington house where they were living, 4 to a bedroom with no hot water, they threatened to leave. Several days later, when they left to go to work, ICE agents were waiting outside their door and picked them up. Now, Mr. Batres is innocent until we prove him guilty, which we plan to do. But over and above these individual folks who were cheated and harmed is a whole concept of people exploiting workers, particularly those who may lack English-speaking skills, or who lack documentation. You exploit them, you threaten to turn them over to ICE, you pay them less. You know, this, folks, is simply wrong. Moreover, for all the legitimate contractors who pay work comp insurance, which isn't cheap, but is there to protect workers, for all the contractors who legitimately hire people, deduct taxes and pay taxes themselves for the workers, for all the people who play by the rules, people like Batres violates them. And that's one of the reasons we in the Hennepin County Attorney's Office are so pleased to be working with everyone here to bring these charges. It will come to trial, and we will convict him beyond a reasonable doubt, I am certain. We need to insist that all workers are treated fairly, and all businesses that follow the rules don't have people like this guy cheating on the side. I'd next like to introduce our Commissioner of Commerce, Jessica Looman. Jessica.
That's great, thank you. Good morning. As Mr. Freeman shared with you, I'm Jessica Looman. I am the commissioner of the Minnesota Department of Commerce. And while in the state system, the Minnesota Department of Labor and Industry has the primary responsibility to administer the state's workers' compensation system, at the Minnesota Department of Commerce, we oversee the insurance industry. And we oversee insurers who provide workers' compensation insurance. And one of our key responsibilities is to prevent and stop insurance fraud. Our goal is to ensure a strong, competitive, and fair workers' compensation insurance marketplace, one that serves the interests of both workers and employers. Workers' compensation is about making sure that when workers are hurt on the job, employees have the insurance to pay lost wages and hospital bills. In this case, workers' compensation fraud has had the worst possible outcome: workers who have been victims of wage theft and workplace injuries. First, I want to thank the workers for coming forward and for CTUL and our other partners for helping them to have a voice. This is very difficult sometimes for workers who are victims of exploitation to come forward and say that they have been victims. Second, I want to thank, and I'm incredibly proud of the work of the Commerce Insurance Fraud Bureau for the thorough investigation that we have done on these violations. Again, working very closely with the victims of these crimes in order to make sure that we understand their story and that we can protect these workers. As the criminal complaint describes, this situation is where employer systematically and blatantly exploited his workers, forcing them to work long hours, making them accept low pay, endangering their safety, and threatening them with the loss of their job and deportation if they said anything at all. The facts as described in the criminal complaint shock the conscience. Their health and safety were put at risk every day, and at least one was seriously injured because of this defendant's willful disregard for their well-being and his willful disregard of the law. This case proves, sadly, that insurance fraud does, in fact, have very real victims. It also reinforces the point that insurance fraud is a part of larger criminal activity. Why these cases can be very complex and challenging and time-consuming to investigate, it is our obligation and responsibility to make sure that thorough investigation and prosecution of these cases happen. I want to thank Mr. Freeman and his office for their partnership with us on this case. And finally, I want to thank the community members and advocates who are here. We know that fraud and other crimes of exploitation are underreported, especially in immigrant communities. Everyone here has a vital role in advocating for victims and bringing these crimes out of the shadow and into the light so we can put a stop to them. This case shows how it can be done. Thank you.
Next, we'd like to hear from Robin Phillips, the Executive Director of the Advocates for Human Rights. Robin?
Thank you so much, and thank you for everyone who's so concerned about this issue. Human trafficking is an international human rights violation and a global epidemic. Research indicates that trafficking yields approximately $150 billion annually and that two-thirds of the victims of human trafficking worldwide are exploited for labor. Human trafficking is also a serious problem in Minnesota. Today's charges reflect a systemic failure in Minnesota. Our research shows that trafficking is a common but underreported crime that involves the exploitation of fear for profit. Minnesota has had a labor trafficking law on the books since 2005, and we're now seeing increased prosecution, which we applaud. Thank you. We are seeing much greater awareness of labor trafficking and labor exploitation in the community, which is necessary for the identification of the crime and increased enforcement. Prosecution may discourage people from being traffickers, but we need to collectively take other steps to prevent trafficking from happening in the first place. Employers should ensure that the human rights of all workers are respected. This responsibility includes protection for their own employees, the employees of contractors they engage, and the employees of companies in their supply chains. We need to educate workers about their rights and prioritize those most vulnerable to ensure that they can identify when they are trafficking victims and seek protection. In addition to improving self-identification, We need to train people in industries and government agencies who commonly interact with people who are at risk of trafficking about how to identify the victims and how to refer them to appropriate services. This case also illustrates the importance for workers of trusted relationships like those with CTUL to help them when they are trafficked and otherwise exploited. We need to build the systems and networks that provide this essential support. These charges send an important message that Hennepin County will not tolerate trafficking and that this is an essential step to ensuring the basic human rights, including dignity, equality, and justice for all workers in Minnesota. Thank you.
Ruth Schultz, the organizing director of the Center for Workers United in Struggle, will translate for Luis, who now our special guest, who will now share some comments about what actually happened.
Buenos días a todos. Mi nombre es Luis Núñez y estoy representando a CTUL en esta mañana.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Luis Núñez. I'm representing CTUL on behalf of the organization this morning.
Soy miembro de CTUL y somos miembros del comité de trabajadores que pertenece a CTUL.
I'm a member of CTUL, and I'm a construction worker who is part of the construction worker committee within CTUL.
CTUL es un centro de trabajadores formado por trabajadores y liderado por trabajadores.
CTUL is a worker center. We were formed by workers and were led by workers.
En este caso de tráfico laboral, nosotros tuvimos un papel muy esencial de apoyar a los trabajadores involucrados.
In this case of labor trafficking, we played an essential role in developing the leadership of the workers who were victims of labor trafficking.
Ayudando a ellos para desarrollar un liderazgo y enseñarles acerca de sus de que hay leyes que los apoyan a ellos.
We developed their leadership to speak out, and we educated them about laws that back them up as workers.
Y que ellos puedan conocer acerca de los abusos que se están dando en este estado de Minnesota.
And that they're conscious of the abuses that are happening to them, but not only them, in the state of Minnesota.
La construcción está lleno de abusos laborales.
The construction industry here is filled with labor abuses.
CTUL está apoyando a trabajadores de construcción y ha apoyado a recuperar en los últimos 10 años, ha recuperado $175,000.
Currently, CTUL is supporting in two other active cases of labor trafficking, apart from this one. And in the last 10 years, we've supported construction workers in recovering $175,000 in stolen wages.
En los últimos 15 años, OCHA ha encontrado 3,500 casos de violaciones de estándares de salud y seguridad en el estado de Minnesota, donde los trabajadores están expuestos a accidentes muy fuertes como quedar en silla de ruedas o hasta la muerte.
In the last 15 years in Minnesota, OSHA has found 3,500 violations of health and safety standards in the state of Minnesota. As you see in this case, workers are exposed to serious accidents where they can be left in a wheelchair or even dead.
¿Quiénes son los responsables de estos abusos? Nosotros vemos que los responsables de estos abusos son los desarrolladores.
And who is responsible for these abuses that happen in the industry? We see that the big developers are responsible for a system that allows these abuses to happen.
Ellos buscan precios más baratos y por consiguiente vienen contratistas y hacen lo mismo hasta que este asunto va floreciendo y llegamos a este momento donde se da el tráfico laboral.
When developers look for the lowest price, all the contractors down the chain also look for the lowest price until you get to the worker who's a victim of wage theft and allows labor trafficking to flourish in this industry. These workers involved in this case were working on projects of two big developers in the Twin Cities, Ruder Walton and Lennar Homes.
Hacemos un llamado a las autoridades y desarrolladores a reunirse con nosotros, el Comité de Trabajadores, para solucionar esta problemática que está afectando mucho y que ha afectado mucho en los últimos 10 años para que no siga pasando lo mismo y evitemos más víctimas de tráfico laboral.
So we're making a call today to the appropriate authorities and to developers in the Twin Cities to meet with us as construction workers to find solutions to the problem that workers are living day by day and make sure that no worker suffers labor trafficking again.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much.
Before we take questions, I want to recognize many of the people who are here, the investigators and people from the Department of Commerce. Mike, thank you for being here. The two lawyers that are actually going to try the case are in the back of the room, and I appreciate very much their good work. I think the folks here from the Center for Workers United in Struggle and the Advocates for Human Rights, thank you. I also want to thank our building trades. We've got folks, now I'm going to maybe get in trouble, but we got electricians, we got laborers. Who else we got? Bricklayers, pipe fitters. Who else, Danny? Well, painters, bricklayers. Wow.
Carpenters.
Hey, we're thankful that you're supporting this effort. It's critical that we stand together to get these things worked out to protect the workers and to protect the people who honestly participate in the construction trades. So with that, questions?
How many workers how many victims are part of this case?
What was the final number? Commissioner?
There's many workers.
There's many workers. Officially, the number of workers that are in the complaint is five.
I know you mentioned that the workers were the ones that brought it to your attention, or whose attention? OSHA, or did they call the police?
So again, this is one of those areas where there's amazing cooperation and partnership. Actually, the workers in CTUL were able to partner with the other community-based organizations, including Advocates for Human Rights, and bring that to Hennepin County, and Hennepin County was able to bring it to us, and we were able to all work together to make sure that we had the resources available to both investigate and then ultimately to prosecute this crime.
I'll just say the workers came here to our office from the outreach we've been doing in the community. They contacted one of our staff, and we sat down and met with them, and then yeah, exactly, like pulled together all the different pieces of the puzzle and working in cooperation with all these different agencies.
And I just want to stress again how important it was that the workers were able to be strong and have a voice in this case, because that makes a huge difference in being able to prosecute this.
So what Luis said, he mentioned two big developers in the Twin Cities. He's citing some violations and labor abuse. Is this normal? Does Lennar get violations a lot when it comes to labor, or is this something new that's coming to light? What's next with those steps?
I'm gonna let you guys go ahead, and then we can talk.
It is normal. These types of violations are normal. We see many workers being threatened with ICE. We see many workers not being able to get the medical care that they need with accidents. And on many large developer projects, it happens under everywhere that where they're using cheap, where they're looking for a cheap bid and using and looking for cheap labor. It is unusual that they're actually found, they're actually reported to agencies and that charges are brought. So the the accident that was spoken about here from different agencies, that happened while building Lennar townhomes, where the worker was injured, and then the boss wanted to say it happened at his house.
So does Lennar get charged, or how does that work? What happens to Lennar?
If I understand it properly, Mr. Batres had a company for which he subcontracted with the general contractor to provide this labor. So the wrongdoer is not necessarily the general contractor, although in many cases they can help us. We didn't need it here because it was very clear what he was doing was wrong. The challenge is a lot of folks don't trust the system, and sometimes with justification. So it took courageous workers to come forward, and frankly, it took an accident like the serious back injury the person suffered and the refusal to provide decent medical care, and then to pawn it off on the rest of it because he was putting money in his pocket. He was paid by the general contractor to provide work comp. You have to do that. Every worker is entitled to work comp, whether you're unionized or not. You're entitled to that protection. And for the worker is entitled to get that. Well, this guy was ignoring that in numerous occasions, and workers were going without help. And then when one had such a serious accident, he had to go to the hospital. Then he comes up with this fraudulent, pop cocky story about, well, he was working on my house. And so you and I, as taxpayers, paid for his health care. And that's just wrong. It's a challenge to get everybody together. It's a challenge. Our friends in organized labor have stood with us and helped us a lot in this case. A lot of the workers don't trust the system very much, and you could kind of understand why they don't. And for us prosecutors, we got to have good investigation, which the Commerce Department does. It's not a well-known fact. The Hennepin County Attorney's Office only has several investigators who basically help to put the case together at the very end. We need people who to work on these kind of cases, and we got that kind of cooperation. So one of the behind-the-scenes story is extraordinary cooperation and trust that developed between all of us.
Do the general contractors get off scot-free then? It seems like they know what they're doing.
Or were they scammed?
If we know that the general contractor is part of it, we can do other things with that. But normally what happens is the contractor is out there, they put out for bids, and they have a company that's there. So what we need, labor trafficking statute basically says labor trafficking is exploiting workers, not paying them what they're supposed to, threatening them with going to ICE. Those are the actions that were illegal that we charged, and we charged the subcontractor with that.
When big developers prioritize a low bid over health and safety standards, then these conditions happen. But right now, they generally get to look the other way because they've subcontracted. And so that's why we do need to talk with them about what they're looking for in their bids, how they ensure the contractors down their chain are respecting all of workers' rights, all the way down to the workers actually putting up the drywall, building, putting on the roofing, all of those different things.
I think you can see in the room the trades are here, right? There's some developers that get it and are doing the right thing, and they're bringing in union labor where people have protected rights, but there's some developers that are just trying to cut corners, right? And those are the ones that need to be held accountable. When they try to cut corners, this is what happens.
I think I'd just like to add that, we've been struggling with how to make sure that the Minnesota construction industry is safe, and also that workers aren't being exploited. And we've struggled, and we've partnered with so many of the people in the room when we're talking about misclassification of workers as independent contractors, which is something that we've seen here, which is really addressing wage theft, which is failure to pay the wages that workers are owed, failure to pay overtime. We've struggled with making sure that the safety standards are there for everyone. Everybody who goes to work every day should be able to come home safe. We struggle to make sure that all of the worker protections, including workers' compensation, including unemployment insurance, including every other requirement that we have in this state are there to protect workers. And it really does undermine our entire economy and every single legitimate construction worker and construction company in this state when we allow that to go unchecked. And this is one way, this is one type of case where we were able to find an employer who completely exploited his workers at the expense of all of the rest of us, in a way just to make a quick buck. And that's not okay, and that's what we're going to continue to investigate, and that's going to continue to prosecute.
Okay, we'll all be here for a while. If you have individual questions, thank you for coming.